Hello, how you doing? Hey, I'm back. It's GEOSynths and it's episode 158. I forgot what to say then. It's been so long. I had to cancel last week because I was doing Synthfest and all good intentions. I thought, okay, yeah, well, I'm going to stop over Friday, take all the gear because I was filming the seminars, and then do the filming on Saturday, get back Sunday, do a few things, and then come in on Sunday and do the show. And yeah, I got back and woke up Sunday morning and thought, oh my God, I feel knackered. So I couldn't do the show. I had to cancel it. But yeah, it was great. It was great, Synthfest. Though, I must admit, because I was in the seminar room, the first one overrun just a little bit, and I didn't really get much chance to actually go round in the other room. So there was loads of things going on, and in between the seminars, I went round with my camera to try and get some, like, you know, a few shots, extra shots, because I was going to do a bit of a montage. Probably still will. And saw loads of people, and they go, oh, Jamie, and I was aware that I've got to go back in there and transfer all my footage over to then clear up the card so then I can film the next seminar. It was like just absolutely nuts. Let me just change direction of my lovely £39 microphone. Anyway, yeah, how you all doing? Synthfest was really, really good, I must admit. It was, I know they sold all the tickets, completely sold out. Before, they used to, you know, they'd sell quite a lot of them, but then they'd sell some on the door, and it's a finite kind of number as well. But it was really good. Saw lots of people, lots of, it was just great to get back out, you know what I mean? I mean, these EMOMs, these open mics, electronic open mics, are great for getting around other people, other synthesizer enthusiasts. And it's a bit like a, you know, the next stage from, you know, remember the days when in lockdown and all that kind of thing. People start to stream, put things together, do videos. It was the next step is the going and performing live. That's what I like about it. But going to an actual trade sort of show when you've got so many people there, and it was great because it's the first time as well where I was able to put the names to faces. I saw the first person who popped up was Chris Davey. He popped over to see me when I was in the seminar room. And it's like, oh yeah. And then other people, they were going, oh, all right, Jamie, how you? And I'm thinking, do I know you? And they say, you know, say their username. Oh God, yeah. And we spoke about this, and we spoke, you know, all these things kind of come back. So it would have been great if I could have just spent a bit more time in that side of things. But still, it was good what I did. You know, as I said, there was three seminars and EMOM. I managed to put a word in to get EMOM there. So Martin Christie found sort of three acts anyway to do that. But anyway, before I go on to that, let me just talk to a few people and say, give you all a bit of a shout out. So I've already mentioned we've got Chris. And we've got Dirk, who's Nordic Noir Music, Robert Harrison, Homegrown, Keith in Watford, Native VS, Tim Grogan, Tim Grogan, they've got, it's got his own YouTube show. Make sure you check that out. What else have we got? We've got Wagyu. Hello, Wagyu. Jan Setter, hello to the congregation. Yes, it is. Where's my thing where I can put that? Ah, this is what I should be moving, shouldn't it? Yeah, sorry. I can't see that. You can't see that. We've got Gas is Strong for this synth. It says Yahweh. Is it Yahweh? You are. Oh, that's what it is. Okay, yeah. It's a lovely synthesizer. Lovely synth. Who else we got? Aaron Vaults. Aquatic Borealis. What else? We've got Culture of Ghosts. Simon Great Batch, yeah, it does some really good videos, actually, like a kind of house music tribute, if you like. I don't want to sort of downplay that, but it sounds great. Hearing all these classic house tracks, you know, being redone, done live with vocalists and all that sort of stuff. No, Didn't I hear GEOSynths passed away today? Come into my life. Anyway, it's sad if it has. Don't know where I saw that. Anyway, yeah, Synthfest. So what did I do? Play maybe a few snippets. They should be going live this week, actually. Oh, there's Mr. Mark Doty. We'll be talking about him in a moment. Let me find. Yeah, so there was Paul with him, first of all. And I'll play a little snippet and you might recognise it. You probably tell from the da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And Paul with him was the sound designer for Vangelis, or one of. He did, it's great, interesting talk, actually. You should definitely listen to it. He did stuff with Vangelis, Stevie Wonder, Jean-Michel Jarre. But the Vangelis thing, just a quick sort of story. Vangelis came over to see the AlkaSynth X, which he was selling for the company. Vangelis played it. He liked it. He liked the sounds, but he didn't particularly like the fact that there was no sensitivity on the keys. So he asked him if he could make his CS80 sound, make these sounds from the Elka onto the CS80. And that's how he got involved, and he started making a lot of sounds. He was working on a lot of sounds, and the project he was working on turns out to be Blade Runner. So, that was an interesting talk. He did have a laser harp thing, but it wouldn't work properly because the ceiling was too low. So there was that one, which was good. Another one was 50 Years of Emu Modular. And here's a little bit of this.
Room were two full aluminium Rode cases. The cases alone were $250. So there's a big case containing the module, but that often went well. Open the key.
Focusing on changing the format.
And it includes little interview bits with Dave Rossum as well. So that was a really good, interesting history on Emu Modular and where the name actually came from, which was really good. There was also this lady, Sarah Anglis, and she's like a composer and a sound design, and she uses a theremin. And also, you know, those, you would have seen them around, you know, say you see people use machines and they'll send like impulses to it, and the machine will, like, you know, a bit like robotics. Each it's like a bell. Each one has like a motor, and it da-da-da-ding, da-da-da-ding. She's all into that. But what she uses a theremin for is she links it up with Max MSP, and uses, you know, it can read the audio and convert it, not into MIDI or CV, but in fast enough so it responds quickly. But she then uses samples, so I'll play a little snippet there.
It's a sort of modern magic. It's a sort of modern...
down the octave.
It's a sort of modern magic.
So she's essentially using it to stretch and change the pitch and the time using the theremin, which is... it's quite a weird way of doing it, isn't it, if you think about it? But it also feels kind of natural. It's a bit like, you know, if you're making a pizza and you're using the dough. No idea where that analogy came from, but never mind. That's what I'm seeing in my mind. It's really sad that Joyce Sims has passed away. I can remember all that music back then. It was my kind of music, definitely. And then finally, there was a touch of EMOM. And here's a bit of Martin Christie himself. Just with the pocket operator. So there was here, and then he had a few artists on. Here's a bit of painting. And a couple of others. So, yeah, they'll be available this week anyway. So that was really good. But that's what I was concentrating on. That's where, if you're at Synthfest and you kind of saw me and then it was just fleeting, well, that was why. Anyway. So, yeah, what have I been I was also on Sonic State. I broke my Sonic State virginity. So that was pretty good. I was quite honoured, actually, to be on there. Though somebody in the comments said, GeoSynths has got a hunchback. So it's the back of my chair there, but anyway.
It's a sound up front, but then it's embedded a little bit into the release stage of a patch, and that's a good way of, as well, of using delays rather than long releases, so you can, when you change chord, you know.
So yeah, I'm waffling on there. So that was good to be on there, and really enjoyed that. And what else was there? There was my EMOM in Blackpool, my second EMOM, and probably slightly less people. Andy Brooks was there. In fact, I've got him queued up, really. So, and I streamed it again, though, because in between the gaps of the artist being on, I just played tunes. But of course, I have got hammered by copyright, and a lot of it won't even show in certain countries now. So I'm going to kind of rethink that. I'm not doing one this month anyway. I've got a lot on, but certainly was good. So here's a little bit of Andy doing his thing with his ever-growing modular system. So yeah, there's a bit of Andy, and one of the reasons why I'm not doing this is because it takes me forever to set all that up over there. It's very, very tiring indeed, so I'm going to have to come up with either not do it streamed anymore, so I can just concentrate on the PA and the lighting, not the lighting on the head, or some other. But anyway. If you were at Synthfest, what sort of stood out for you? Was it any particular piece of gear? Was it, for me, it was just seeing people again with it all. Even though, I was stuck behind three of them, a camera. It was going back into the main room and seeing people and seeing, it was great. It was great, I must admit. It's just a pity, really, they don't do it another day. Oh, yeah, Chris Devy, the Analog Solutions Colossus. The Colossus was there with the expander, like it needs an expander. I mean, it was there in 2019, but it was the only the bottom half, I think. So it was the big monstrous one. I love Analog Solutions stuff. It's even though you've got good, remakes by Behringer and things like that, Analog Solutions have just got that their own sound. It's just massive. In fact, I've picked up a couple of other new ones. Well, not new, but they're used. What did I get? I've got, I don't know if you'll see this, actually. Will you see it? No, you won't, because I haven't set the camera up. I've got one of those Impulse Commands, and one of the older fuse boxes, as well as having the Leipzig V3, which I did a review of a while ago, and they just sound gorgeous. It's just a big blanket of synth that wraps around your ears, and I don't care if it's like it's a monosynth or paraphonic, or mind you, I better not say those words because apparently they're not right. Andy Brooks says, let me see if I can get that up. yeah, the people love the Godfather and the Nobula stuff. Core Green was fab. Huddersfield Uni, loads of stuff, but mostly the people. Yeah, I mean, I got roughly 5 minutes to go down the downstairs one. I didn't get to see Luke. I've been trying to get another person on the show for ages, and we just schedules. And I missed him by 10 minutes. And then I saw Jim Glue, and then I realised the time was like, I've got to get back and plug in for the EMOMs and all that sort of stuff, so get recorded for that. It was very, very enjoyable, and I'm glad that the kind of all this has come back. And while, yeah, I did sort of notice it must have been a spreading event, or we've got to get past all that stuff now. We can't hide in our houses anymore. We've got to get out and just live. Otherwise, what's the point? What's the point? Anyway, that's enough of my seriousness, you know. So what is kind of new? Well, it is this. And I say new because I bought one of these and I made a bank of patches with it. Halfway through, it died. So I got another one. That died. Then I got a third one, made the bank of patches, put them out, and it died. They all died. It was the same thing. It was the USB fried something on there, so they were all early models, so I believe all that is fixed now, but it was just, I think it was too much power from USB going into it, I don't know. So but when the last one died, I'd already put the sounds out, and I thought, well, you know, all it's got is essentially one factory bank and one user bank. Now they're a little bit when it comes to user banks on here, a user bank on here is 16 patches. But in my world, a bank is either 100 sounds or it's 128. You know, so there is factory 128, and then there's user 128. Now, I think I might be right, I might be wrong. I might have been either the first or the second person to put a bank of patches out for this. And I thought, well, there's no point after that, because once they fill up, people don't buy them again, buy any more. But they have added, now it turns out, the new firmware update, they've added some new ones, some extra banks. They said 8 banks, and I was thinking, oh, great, you know, whatever. It's actually turned out to be 8 of 16. If you know what I mean. So another 128 slots, but you also can write over the factory. So in a sense, you do get 4 banks of 128. So that might be worthwhile, I thought, to go and get. So I went and got one. I went and got another one. And I must admit, you know, getting back into it, or trying to get back into it, because it was only, is it yesterday? Well, the day before, Friday it might have been, when I picked it up. You know, and, you know, you have to learn the synth again, especially at my age with my brain. And it's just a beautiful sound in synth. I mean, you can tell from that first sound. But they've added some new additional things in the firmware, which is the headliners really are loopable envelopes. And then, you know, once you've looped, turned them on, you can either have envelope 1 or envelope 2 or both. You can then, they'll be looping, and then you can just mess around with modulating some of the other parameters, and you can get almost like what you can do in the modular world, where you can get really fast you know, triplet attacks and all that sort of stuff, rolling sounds. That's what it sounds like to me anyway. Some of the things, destination for vintage knobs. So you can set, you know, per voice and go to the vintage. And then, so you get more swirly stuff. But it doesn't really need that much, because it can sound very, very diverse. So, I can show you now, hopefully. Where's my overhead? Ah, there we go. So I'm going to have to, excuse me, I'm going to put my glasses on. Yes. That has got to that stage now as well. yeah, dodgy eyes. Right. Excuse me on my microphone. So now we've got these extra banks. Normally you go to bank 8 and then go bank 8, and then you'd have all your various different, you know, patches, whatever like that. Thank you. But now we can go bank 9, and then we've got 16, and then 10, 16, and so on and so on, which is good. And you can also overwrite the factory patches as well. So I've done, what did I do? Well, this one here was just a slight demonstration of what you can kind of do with it, really. Just one note for now. So it's an ARP, and you'll hear that I've got the envelopes looping, envelope 1, which is for the filter, and then I'm modulating the decay to get this kind of triplet-y type of sound. And then it'll go into FM territory. Well, actually, AM, really. So, you know, it's not going to win awards, that sound. No, certainly not. But it's something that you can really do before. I can just quickly show you, actually, what I sort of did. So, let's knock it down. Octave apart. Let's just have a little kind of short sort of sound, stick it in mono, which is unison. Don't need, because it's going to be repeating an ARP, don't need sustain on it. Probably re-trigger the envelopes, actually. Here we go. Let's get that down. And one thing I like to do is then, you know, stick the synchronize the LFO. You've got two LFOs on here. One is global, so it'll affect all your voices. And then the other one is per voice. So that's great for if you do the traditional trick of an LFO going to pitch fine. And then for each voice, it will be at different stages, which is what you sometimes have to do to fake a little bit of movement. One thing I like to do is to actually use an LFO, a synchronized LFO, to the cutoff. Let me see if you can get that. Right. So I can go to LFO, find it, I mean, dodgy eyes. So LFO 1 goes to the cutoff, and then we'll find our shape. That's free running LFO. It's synchronized, but it's not being re-triggered each note, which is not what you want really for if you want something to sweep through a sound, sweep through an arpeggiated sound, don't have your LFO re-triggered. And what I'm doing there is just changing up the LFO shape. So that's right, it's going over there. But then what you can do then is then go into, say, LFO 2. Find LFO 2. And then you can apply that to the rate of LFO1. Good old. And then synchronize that. And then, you know, you mess around with, tweak around with the ratios between that, and you can get these kind of counter rhythms. And then what we've got now is these new... I'm going to have envelope retrig is the ability. I'm going to just put unison 2, just detune it a bit. And yeah, they've added slew parameters now, which are really good. I wish a lot of synths had that on. Envelope repeat, and we can choose either envelope 1 or 2. So we've got this short little staccato type of sound now, and then we can then just use an LFO or an envelope. We've got others we could use, but... Let's use LFO 1 because it's global and have that knocking over to the decay of, and of course a lot of these things you can do on other synths, so it's not limited to just what this can do. So envelope 1 decay. And so that's one of the new kind of things that that's in it. Those little tiny little parameters. And, you know, once you mess around with the ratios, but that's something that I do quite a lot on synths is have, you know, the LFO sweeping through the sound that's in sync, but then use the other LFO to change the rate of that as well. And then once these LFOs are locked in, you can then use them to send to other places. Now, that was that. Get rid of it. But this was a kind of pad sound that I made that's using some of it, these kind of techniques, as well as the destination, a vintage knob, using that as a destination.
Let's just check this out. And that's just, you know, it didn't take long to do that. It's probably like 5 minutes or something to knock that up. Because one other thing they've done, you hear that sound. It's kind of, turn the effects off so you can hear it. It's kind of, you hear this fizz. What's actually going on, I'm using an envelope, an inverted envelope. So you get with normal envelopes, what happens is you'll have your attack, your decay, and your sustain. So, like, you push the keys, the attack will go up, it'll go hit to the top of the attack, and then it'll fall into the decay stage, and then it'll just sit then at the sustain level. Just stay there. Now, with inverted or negative envelopes, you can get an uplift of the sound, because it's instead of going from dark to bright, it's doing it the other way. But there's some weird stuff that goes, some spooky at a distance stuff that goes on with inverted envelope. So what addition they've done now is that you can send oscillator 2 and have it bypass the filter completely. So I've only got oscillator 1 going through the filter. Oscillator 2 on that sound is completely open. However, it is still being controlled by the amp envelope. Yeah. Turn up the octave, might help. So if I turn down oscillator 2, it's going to mess around with it because it's an FM sound as well. But anyway, so we've just got oscillator 1 playing. You'll hear the inverted envelope. It should start to come back up. So you're creating a bit of a trough in the sound, and I sometimes use that, especially for layered synths, is once you get into that trough, you can then bring something else on another layer, and it's like you're crossfading from one to the other. Now, just put that patch back on, because I'm using FM, and of course, FM changes pitch, doesn't it? But this is now with oscillator 2, and it just bypasses the filter. So we're getting our dip down, and we're also getting oscillator 2 doing its thing over the top. So it's like, it gives the impression of being a layered sound. And that's just dry. Bit of pan spreading in there, and LFO slowly moving the pan from left to right when you're using aftertouch. And then the vintage-y type of thing. Now, if you could make that sound a little bit thicker, actually, because it's a bit of a tip for you. You know, sometimes if you put two oscillators together, you detune, the usual thing. Let me get my mug up there. The usual thing. But then you've got a sub, and you want to use the sub, and you can't, because like it goes into mush and all that sort of stuff. So what you can do, in fact, I'll just show you what it is. Normally, you've got two oscillators, and they're both
at the same octave range, and you get this. Sounds lovely, blah, blah, blah. And you bring in the sub, and it's just a big mush. And what I tend to do on a lot of synths is just knock up oscillator one, or the oscillator where your sub is tied to, so you get a higher octave, and then it brings the sub into the playable range then, and they're usually like a square wave anyway, so it doesn't do a lot. And then you get a thicker sound. You're essentially using three oscillators then to get your sound. And then with some effects on, and then modulation to the effects, and then you get... That's, you know, it's just a few additional things that they've done that has made a massive difference to me anyway. And I love this synthesizer. The only downsides to this synth is it'd be great. Do you know, if they do a Rev 3, that this is what it should be. It should be this, 61, double the amount of voices. Yeah. It's just you can play it. I mean, I just like playing big chords. So, you know, I feel sometimes that it's more than five voices would be great. But, you know, when you look around now and see what the prices are of synths, because they've all shut up, haven't they? It's like the stock market when you look at the prices of synths these days. Let me just turn down my heating, because I've got one of these cheap, or relatively cheap, Sony EV10 cameras, and even 1080p overheats and turns itself off. Anyway, so I have to have it very cold in here. anyway, that was a bit of there of the Take 5. I won't go on too much because obviously sort of time. So any kind of questions from people? Comments on that at all? Sounds awesome, says Tim. Yeah, thank you, Tim. Tim, you do really well, actually, with one of these. It has a slightly different sound. It's got the sequential DNA, but it does just more. I love it. I love this synth. And it was obviously, you know, I've talked enough about it. Go and check it out. Also, on my website, geosynths.com, 15% off all my synth libraries. So you can check that out, and you can see that I've done Take 5 patches. There's 128 of them, and of course, every single patch I make is demonstrated. I always do that, so you know exactly what you're getting, and I can't be accused of fillers. There might be some sounds you don't like, but that's not a filler. And believe me, I've had one or two people say, "Oh, you do fillers." It's like, get. So, enough of that. If you want to support what I do, you can go to geosynths.com, 15% off any of my patch libraries, and there are loads of them, 21 different synths. Arturia, Polybrew, DeepMind 12, there's four banks of that, in fact, plus loads of bonus banks. King Korg, Nord Lead A1, Wave 2, even the original JX3P, and of course all the sequential Moogs and Super 6 and all that sort of stuff, Diva and Repro. So yeah, if you like what I do, then please buy some patches. You get something in return as well. So that's always good, isn't it? What else is there? It looks like I'm going to run out of time here, doesn't it? A bit of a question I posed in the group. I have a group, Synth Show, GeoSynths on Facebook. Been busy with your synths this weekend. What have you been up to? So what have you been up to this week with your synths? Have you been buying new ones? Have you been rebuilding your studio, moving stuff around, only to realise that the cable you've got just doesn't quite reach, and you've moved everything around like solitaire? You? Oh, got to order some more cable. I hate it when that happens. So, yeah, what else have you got up to? Yeah, I will get onto that now, actually. Aaron's reminded me. Arturia. There was this picture that popped up, wasn't there? I don't know. It doesn't really tell you a lot, but at least maybe it's something physical. Apparently there's going to be a live stream on Tuesday. Rendezvous, which does make you think, Jar. It makes you think, you know, because it's a French company. Will it be hardware? I don't know. I hope it is. I hope they do some hardware, and I hope they do a little... It might be like a Micro Freak, because they must have sold tons of them things. Some people speculated maybe it's an Alcasynthex software typey thing. Even though Cherry Audio have recently done one in terms of plugins, some kind of link up with Korg, taking over Korg's software synths. Who knows what it might well be? What do you think? Andy is saying, playing with the Bitbox Micro, and some bloke gave me a Hysteria oscillator that I've been playing with. Yes. Yes. I hope you're enjoying that. It's pretty good, isn't it? Though the tracking can be a little bit off. I spent ages with, because there's new generation of that. There's the 1.1. It's quite, looks different as well. Anyway, Arturia Groovebox would be sweet. Well, that's only because you do that. Dean just does loads of packs for groove boxes. In fact, you do some for the Poly and Play recently, I think so. Yeah, it would be, in a sense. I hope maybe they do something a little bit new. That'd be good, wouldn't it? The Matrix Brute, the Poly Brute, and all their other analog synths are good, apart from those low mids. I don't like those low mids. So it'd be good if they did something totally new. I don't know. Right, who else? Pigments Hardware would be cool. Ooh, that would be, actually. In fact, that's reminded me. I've been seeing a lot of people been getting their hands on the third wave synthesizer. You know, the kind of wavetable-y synth that sounds great. Pigments in Hardware, it kind of would be similar to that, wouldn't it, to a degree? Yeah, there's not really a lot going on, but who knows? Rendezvous, bit of Arturia, Jean-Michel Jarre, that's what I'm thinking. Don't know, who knows? I mean, someone's mentioned the Origin Wagyu. God, do you remember that? Didn't that just die a death? The Origin. Yeah, maybe it will. So let's play a bit of something I found. What's that? No, that's not the one I wanted. Oh, yeah, I've got to plug this as well, because this was great. I had an interview with Marcus Ryle, who you all know from Oberheim days, and then the recreation, well, the new Oberheim OBX 8, but of course I didn't know all the other things really that he did work, you know, with his company he set up and created ADAT as a thing. I mean, that's just amazing. He's done loads. So make sure you check out that my interview with that. It was not last week, it was the week before.
Digital, analog, and everywhere in between.
So that was there. But yeah, I was looking for a video of audio, but I can't find which one it is. I've got so many up here now. Away, Mrs. No, I can't play that. Oh well. Riveting stuff. Oh, I like this. I like this. it's popped up with it. Retro Sound. He's on a track now. He's brought out his Roland GX 3P and layered it all up. So check this out. Thank you. which sounds great. Somebody said, actually, it not only sounds, but also looks as 80s as it gets, and it does, doesn't it? That's a synth. The JX3P is a synth I've bought three times. And I've got one. It's got the organics board in it, but it's all a little bit... half things don't work on it. So it works over MIDI, but physically, doesn't it? The controls scratch when they go up, and the brightness... Is it brightness? That doesn't even do anything. But yeah, classic synths. I really like the sound of that one. Right, in terms of news, there's not been a lot that's kind of caught my attention. This was sounded all right, though. I've got like a bit of a modular. I'm not mega into it, I'll be honest with you, because... I have to think too much when I'm doing so. I'll do it and I'll spend ages patching it. And at the end of it, I'm thinking, I could have knocked that up in 2 minutes on another synth. So and there's just a lot to learn. However, one thing I have noticed, or really maybe my experience is not great enough, is that there's effects units around. A lot of us are using like pedals or, external sort of effects. Or, you can get things like this big Strymon. I know Tim's got the Strymon ones that go in there. But, they're great, and that's what they do. But there's not a lot of multi-effects. So it was quite interesting to see this one from Andrew Huang come out, which is multi-effects of, it's called Ghost. It's got compression, distortion, delays, reverb, that sort of stuff. And it sounds pretty good.
And this is the length of the decay. And the secondary parameter of the tail, the decay knob, is pre-delay. So it can be pretty much instant or have a little bit of a onset time.
So yeah, I mean, that's come out. I'm really impressed with it, actually. It sounds very, very good. There's quite a few sort of videos out there. $475, so that'll probably equate to something very similar in pounds. Would I go that? Probably not. Dean's saying, Eurorack is about the process, not the speed. Yeah, I get that. And when I'm in that, when I'm in the space, it's great, the plain space, but... when you do this for a living, you're constantly thinking, I'm wasting time here, I should be working. So, I don't know. Though, I have been trying to come up with some different ways, because when I've done these EMOMs, I go out with a Nord Wave 2, and that's what I play live, and an MPC. And the MPC... I'm doing it so many different ways. I'm essentially using sequences like scenes. So one scene would be the verse, and another scene would be, or sequence would be the chorus. And I just find that way of doing it on there absolutely awful. I've been recommending, you can do things with mutes and bring things, but that means I've got to physically be on and looking at that. I want to be on the keyboard, So I'm trying to come up with some of the way, but still keep it hardware of doing my tracks. Digitac, that sort of stuff just isn't right for me because there's just not enough polyphony there for the things to do. So there's nothing quite... I want logic in hardware, that's what I want. But yeah, I'm trying to come up with something a little bit different because the last one I did at EMOM, it was at the end of the night, and because I was doing the sound as well, nobody told me that my stuff was only coming out one side. So when I come back and played the stream, it was like, what? So I'm all over, everything's over there, but it was loud in there, so I guess people didn't notice. So I can't really use that one. But yeah, I've just got to come up with a different way that's a bit more fluid. But it still allows me to play. Or just totally rethink the way I'm doing and just go. Because a lot of people who do perform don't play keys. You don't need to, you know. It's about manipulating the sound over time and so on. So maybe that's what I should be doing. Just kind of thinking out loud. We were all telling you on the stream, says Native VS. Yeah, but the thing is, I couldn't see the stream because I was playing. what it was, the problem was, I'll tell you what it was. I had an 8-way loom. And each of the jacks were color-coded. But under the lights, the colors looked different. So I plugged the wrong ones in, didn't I? Well, what I thought was blue was something else. And I plugged that in. So hence, it only come out one side. Hey, whatever. You live and learn, don't you? So anyway, Ghost. I really do like that one. And I'm not totally familiar with a lot of effects that are based in Eurorack. I mean, I've got one of those. Wrong one. I've got a Disting EX, and that can do effects. But I tell you, I don't use it. I don't use the Disting. I just find the little screen just, you know. I don't know. Maybe I just don't have that kind of mind. I think that's how it is. It's just easier for me with just something like this. I just take this out. And where am I? Yeah, fiddle sticks. So some of this is just so much easier for. Favorite sounds, actually, that, and that's in my bank, GeoSynths bank, for Essence, for the Take 5. What shall I do next? Oh, I've only got 5 minutes left anyway. Oh yeah, this was good. This was finally dropped at Synthfest, or the first time showed in the UK, and I really like this. I think I'm gonna go for it when it comes. What is it, about 565 quid?
Players of Panther.
Yeah, let's have a listen. Here we go. So this is one of the presets. So to select your presets, you have it there on the screen, and then you can just change it and then press select.
Is that changing preset mid bar, or does it change on the boundary?
It's changing it at the moment when I select it, basically. Right. But if I want to, I can set it so it'll, you know, do it on the bar. So you've got lots of really contemporary presets in there. That's pretty hardcore, yeah.
I think I'm developing a nosebleed.
So yeah, that's a bit of the drum log that's finally kind of been shown. When I did go around and managed to have a look, took some footage, there was just too many people around. It was impossible to actually even try something. Roger says, I still have a Corgi R1. The drum log sounds great. Yeah, the Corgi R1, I remember those. A1 and the ER1. One was red. The red one was the drums, and the blue one was the analog, the 303 type of thing. Yeah, I remember those. I bought them as well, and I had no idea how to use them. I just used them as sound modules, really, not the sequencing side of things. I just don't get that way of doing things. I think it's just me. My brain don't work like that. Anyway, what else was there? Okay, quickly, I don't think I'll go into that because it needs a bit of a longer. It's a bit of a hardware jam I found. Eric Muro. Let's check this out. If that's using samples of 909s or an RD9. I bought one of those RD9s, the Behringer ones. Some weird stuff happens with the snare drum and the clap. They go out, they phase with each other. Certain setting, which sounds well weird. But it sounds okay, you know, as long as you use the separate outputs. If you do it just for that mono output, why do they do that? I don't know. It doesn't sound great. But yeah, there was Eric's video. Really good, that. Enjoyed that. Some really good stuff. Oh yeah, there's a mate of mine in Blackpool. He's I've known him for years, and he's done music. Yeah, that's how I kind of knew about him. I mean, I'm talking 25 years. And we never ever ended up doing anything together. And, you know, life and family and all that sort of stuff. So he's always had his little setup at home. And... but this whole Lee Mom thing has kind of inspired him a little bit. So, Awkward Tom, here's a bit of his jam. So there's a bit of Colin, otherwise known as Awkward Tom. So do me a favour and subscribe to him. That'd be great. Let me just share it, actually. Make sure you do that. It'd really be a great thing for you to like this video, like the stream. You know, that always helps and all that kind of thing. But also like that. That'd be great. Because, you know, he's not wanting to do anything for quite, well, not, you know, a lot of us. You need a reason to do something, and this EMOM thing has inspired me. I don't know why. It's not necessarily for anything that I see I can do professionally. It's not that. It's, I don't know. It's just getting out there, I suppose, and doing something. So, yeah. There'll be more in Blackpool. There'll be more EMOMs. Just got to work out a few things. Right, what else was there in terms of news? I don't think there was really much. This was a little cute thing that I found. Japanese poetry. Huh? What are you on about? It was this video, it just appeared on my feed somehow, and it was Japanese poetry and poetry synthesizers. Like, that's a thing. I'm sure Wagyu knows. But it's like these synthesizers that come out in the 80s, which were like, using like a Kyoto sound, and then there was Japanese poetry over the top. But there's this video that's all about it. And there's a whole load of them, these different ones, and he talks about the history of it all.
Brings more sing-song nature to the poetry and introduces negative scales instead of more ambiguous.
But I just found it fascinating. That's it's a wing of synthesizers I didn't know anything about. Maybe it should have stayed that way. I don't know. But it was a good video. It was good that somebody's done that. Where are we? Oh, God, I've run over, haven't I? All right, okay. I'll just do... What else was the... Not doing that. Done that. What was that? Oh, I don't know what that was. I'm going to leave that one. I've done that. Demon core. I think, you know what? I think I've covered pretty much everything that I wanted to cover. Yeah, that's great. So, what's coming up for me? Don't know. Going to start working on some new patches. But I'm not 100% sure which one I'm going to carry on. I've got two synths to finish off, which are the Summit, and that's its own patches. I recently did a bank for the Peak, which was Zenith Volume 3, they're amazing, actually. They're blowing me away, and I make them. but I'm doing some for the Summit, but they're all dual-layered sounds or splits, and the new sounds, they're not the same ones. And also, I've got to finish off these OBX8 patches. But I don't know, there's just so many people putting stuff out now, and it's all jump and vintage, and that's great. Vintage sounds are fine and everything, but they're not the most challenging, because a lot of vintage sounds were just like, two oscillators, detuned, then what? A bit of LFO go, wah, 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 wah. Not the most challenging, and that synth can do a lot more. Can certainly do a lot more. What else am I working on? I've done my Synthfest videos. They're fine. They're all gone. And, I'm doing some music. I started writing some music. Because I've tried to write with the MPC. I can't do it. I can, but it just takes forever, and it can't do everything. So what I'm doing is I'm doing it all in Logic. Then I'm going to bounce out the stems, leave out what I'm going to play live, and do that. That's the way that I've kind of thought about doing it. So I'm working on something now, which is sounding quite nice. And it's more me type of music. The other stuff I've done is just like, just to do something. A bit of a plug as well. Sonic State are doing an EMOM down in Bath. Could have sworn I've got that set up somewhere. There we go. Yeah. On the 26th of November. So I'll be down there. I've booked my hotel at 10 miles away because a hotel in Bath on a Saturday night, and I'm talking a Premier Inn, not like a Ritz or anything, but it was something like £250 for one night in Bath. It's like, Jesus. So I'm a bit of a distance away from that. I'm going to go down there. So that should be good. Because, talking to Nick and what he's got set up for, it's going to be an amazing night. Really, really good. Anyway, guys, thank you very much. I suppose better go now. Should have had a shave as well. Sorry for that. Do you like my fancy lights behind me as well? It's not that I want to become a YouTuber. It's just that I was on Cash Converters. And they had these lights, up lights. I got them for £20 for the two. Because they're unbranded, so they didn't know. But they got batteries and charge them. They go on for ages, so they're now my YouTube lights, so I can look like a YouTuber. I've got to get the right colours, though, haven't I? It was red and blue, but it's something else now. It's like a kind of purpley thing. You can strobe them. Yeah, you can do all that. I've got a DMX controller in here somewhere, so, But it's quite nice, isn't it? It's a nice little backdrop. Anyway, enough of that. So thank you very much all for watching. Next week, I'm not sure what I've got on. I've got some fingers in pies things out there for people that I want to talk to, but I'm going to do like an interview, try and do one a month with somebody. But anyway, other than that, thank you very much, and I shall leave you with I've got this up for some reason, but it looks like it's a cover. Oh, well, I'm getting done anyway. Thanks very much, guys, and goodbye.